Hello, everyone. I'd like to call this February 28th, 2017 Shelburne Select Board meeting to order. First item is to consider approval of the agenda. Having spoken a little while ago with Joe, I don't think there's a need for an executive session this evening. Does anyone else have any comments on that or anything else?
I agree.
Good? Everybody's good? Somebody like to move to approve?
Move to approve as amended.
Moved by Colleen, seconded by Jerry. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, that passes. Next, let's do them one at a time. Consider approving the minutes of January 24th. And I have to tell you, Joe, I didn't see those minutes.
They're at the back.
Oh, they are back there? Oh. Anyone have any changes or anything? Okay, hearing none. Someone like to move to approve?
Move to approve.
Moved by Colleen, seconded?
I'll second.
Jerry wasn't here, so I'm assuming you're going to abstain. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And one abstention.
Correct.
Jerry. All right, next is minutes of February 14th, Valentine's Day, and I noticed they did not include that I sang to my wife. I'm a little disappointed about that, but
I'm going to abstain because I wasn't here.
Okay, anybody have any changes?
I will abstain as well.
Okay, that's right, we had the three of us. All right, someone like to move to approve?
The only thing was that when we had the legislature here, we were talking about also education funding and how, you know, Shelburne has a history of giving more than they've received, and that wasn't mentioned anywhere in here.
I don't remember, did we talk about that?
I remember we talked about it, but I don't remember who brought it up or who said what. So if you
someone
think,
might.
Do you think it's real?
Yeah. No, not necessarily.
Okay. So you want to move to approve the minutes?
So moved.
Moved by Jerry, seconded by Colleen. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
And you two guys are abstaining, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Next up is public comments. Number four, Lou Gehrig's number. If anyone has anything they'd like to bring up to the board now that is not on tonight's agenda over which this board has jurisdiction, now is your time to do so. Anyone? Okay, next up is select board comments. Josh, got anything?
I guess all I'd like to encourage is to remind everybody that Election Day is next week, and a lot of people put work into preparing, I mean, the town, the candidates, the fire company. So I encourage everybody to remember that and get out and vote next week, or vote early.
Sir?
I'll second that, and to attend town meeting.
I'm sorry, I forgot
that. One evening, if you're able.
Great, and at town meeting, we are also going to be announcing the recipient of the Colleen Haag Public Service Award, which should be a very nice time. Colleen?
Just that, you know, there's the dinner prior to the town meeting,
right.
Both at the Shelburne Community School, and also just to comment on that it's been a very civil race, and that I wish all the candidates luck. I mean, I wish my fellow candidate some luck, not total luck, but but it's been very civil. It's been very nice.
John.
I'll second what Colleen said. It's been a pleasure to campaign for re-election, and I look forward to all the voting that will take place next week. And I think, as Josh mentioned, the fire company with the Quint on display is quite an impressive piece of equipment, and we would all feel better at night with that in our barn. So that's it. That's all I have.
So I'll just make a real quick comment. If you want to step out for a second, that'd be great. If you don't want to, it's going to be real fast about the litigation. March 27th and March 28th, The federal court litigation is scheduled to be heard in Burlington, I believe, on the 27th. It starts at 9 o'clock. And it should be a dramatic hearing. So just wanted to keep everybody informed that that is going on, and urge everyone to read again the January 12th decision and order by Judge Sessions. All right, town manager's report.
All right, I'll try to be brief, but we've been trying in vain mostly to fill the buildings and grounds maintenance tech position that was vacated at the new year. It's been a difficult process, but we think we found a winner who's going to be a very good addition to the town team, who's going to start a little bit before April 1st. But I don't know if other people have noticed this, but we've been contracting out the cleaning services over the last month or so, and I think there's been a dramatic, noticeable improvement in the town offices. Certainly people here have noticed it a lot, and I want to thank the gentleman who we're contracting for his good work on that. Real quick, I don't know if this rings a bell to the select board. This probably came up when the Tree Advisory Committee came before the board many months ago, but we actually have something in the town tree policy that provides the town, it's a policy, not an ordinance, so it provides the town with the authority to have people remove trees that are dead, diseased, etc., that might cause public health or other hazards to neighboring properties. And I've actually had a noticeable uptick in people contacting me regarding this policy with concerns of trees in their neighborhood. And we've been hesitant to apply it because we're not sure if we have the teeth to do so or not. But I just want the board to realize that this might be something that comes up a little bit more after town meeting in terms of how we'll be dealing with these issues moving forward. The water line project, so, you know, we almost made it through the year without another Spear Street water line break, but last week we did have one, actually along a section of the line that will be replaced. We just hadn't made it that far south, so there was about a half a day last week when a good portion of town was without water. We fixed it as quickly as possible, and again, that is a section that will be replaced with this project. So I think it goes to show yet again that the project was certainly needed. And then just internally over the last week, staff is preparing for town meeting and looking forward to have a successful time. So thank you.
Thanks, Joe. All right, item number 7. Consider a motion encouraging the state of Vermont to provide municipalities more economic development incentive options. And I had a brief talk with Josh just before the meeting, and perhaps that, if we go forward, that could be the proposed motion right there.
Mm-hmm.
So, Joe, why don't you give us a little intro on this?
Sure, I think this came up quite a bit. Well, yeah, when our legislators and state senators were here at the last meeting, I think we veered into discussion about TIF districts, and the legislature is looking at lifting the cap for those. Currently, they're only authorized for a select few of municipalities, and certainly within Vermont, there's been some issues with how they talk to or don't talk to very well the education funding, and there's been some messes that other communities have gotten into with them for sure, but around the country, they have been used and worked successfully in certain situations, and we don't have a lot of tools in our pockets as municipalities to incentivize economic development, and potentially this is one that we could be using. I wouldn't go as far as saying at this point that we should be endorsing it for Shelburne. There's pros and cons to them, but I thought it might be a decent idea to at least signify that we have an interest in pursuing them. And if so, then I would be able to, or another officer of the town would be able to go to the State House and advocate on behalf of the town. certainly I wouldn't want to do that if the board wasn't interested in pursuing this any further. So I don't think that we're trying to go as far tonight as saying, yes, Shelburne definitely wants this, or we've definitely identified an area of town that we want to apply this to. No, we're not saying that. I think what we're trying to say would be just providing our support for enabling legislation. And so I'll leave it at that. I know Representative Brumstead is here, and we can talk about it more.
Great.
And I also want to say Jerry has some experience in Maine working on TIFs, and I think that he has found them in his professional background to be useful in the right circumstances as well. So I've talked offline to Jerry about them as well.
Great. I did too. Jerry, you want to say something on this?
Yeah, I think our resolution is of vital importance because it addresses the general nature of incentivizing development, which locality by locality is going to differ. That we probably would be a little challenged with a TIF in terms of proportionality and scale. Not the least because US 7 has been redone. But it signals an interest on the parts of town to develop potentially an economic development corporation that serves a lot of the same functions as a TIF would, a TIF district would. And I think our support for a change in state policy is really very, very important. And hopefully will strengthen your role in the Government Ops Committee as this gets discussed and treated.
Thanks, Jerry. Josh, John, Colleen, thoughts? You guys? Go ahead, John.
The only thing I have questions about was, you know, we don't talk in broad brush. TIF keeps coming up in everything that I've read in the materials. And I can't sit here and endorse the TIF approach as the proper approach. It seems to me to be almost fiscally irresponsible to borrow money and then use potential development to pay it back. I just can't see that in a logical happen. To what Jerry said, I would be fully supportive of some incentives for economic development. And if that meant tax cuts or, you know, those type of things, I think that anybody could endorse those kind of things. So I see a conflict in just the materials I've read in the packet. So I think that, you know, we need to take a hard look. So, you know, whatever motion we put forward, I think we have to look at it in that way. So,
I want to thank Jessica because she's, as state representative, she's reached out to us and we've had some fruitful email discussions back and forth on this. So thank you very much. A TIF, by the way, in case anyone doesn't know, it's tax incremental financing. And it's usually applied to certain districts. Historically, it's districts that are in blighted. They're in a bad state. Recently, however, communities across the country that have used TIFs have expanded their use to other areas, which in our particular case could be our mixed-use district, which we have recently addressed with a change in zoning, our form-based zoning approach. And there are, John is absolutely correct, as usual, and there are pros and cons to it. One of the purposes of this motion is not for this board to say we want to do a TIF. Mm-hmm. One of the main purposes of this motion or resolution, if we decide to go forward with it, is to ask the legislature to provide municipalities, including Shelburne, with the option of pursuing economic development programs, including the possibility of using a TIF. Because right now, the municipality of Shelburne doesn't have that ability to do that. So this resolution would be asking the legislature to make it possible for the state of Vermont to provide municipalities with economic development incentive options that might include a TIF.
Maybe that's the wording I was talking about before, is instead of specifying TIFs, specify, you know, additional economic incentive opportunities.
Yeah, that's...
And that would, that could deal with...
We could, I think the one thing, I'm in favor of mentioning TIF because that's what's before the legislature right now. And that's, and we want to provide our state rep with something to show that the town of Shelburne is interested in pursuing economic incentives, and it might include a TIF. We are not saying by any means that we're doing a TIF in the mixed-use district or downtown or anywhere. And Jessica, I see you're ready to talk, so please.
Let me just say quick, I have a quick, I'm going to go over here because I'd rather sit. So I'm Jessica Brumstead, and I brought with me a copy for everybody of the bill that Kate and I introduced, which would lift the cap at least for Shelburne. But there's an even better bill that I brought, which is the Senate introduced a bill for economic development, which is all about lifting the cap totally and allowing every county to have two more towns that have TIFs. The reason for just not lifting the cap and saying anybody can do it is that on the House side, the Ways and Means Committee is not super supportive of these because they think it takes away from education dollars. And the reality is, as Joe and I spoke, that most of the areas that you want to draw the line around, so that's how they think of TIFs. They think of, you know, you'd have a square area that you would freeze at that moment in time. And whatever you're paying in property taxes inside of that square, that's what you'll continue to pay for 20 years. And the new thing, the money that you might make new based on the new development would get to go back to the town to help pay off the bond that you would take in order to be able to do some sort of development, if that's what you decided to do. And as you said, this does not bind Shelburne in any way to do this. This is just, as Joe said, another tool in our toolbox. But the interesting thing about the Senate, the Senate has never been super supportive of expanding the programs either, but this year they are, and it's because affordable housing is so important that they're thinking that maybe TIFs with interesting and smart developers out there could think of ways to make this a way to help with affordable housing. For example, you know, maybe you could have a building that had a storefront on the bottom but some affordable housing on the top or something around that. And they're not really stating it, but that's the sense that we have, that there's an ulterior motive here as well. So as far as I'm concerned, if I know that Joe has wanted to look into TIFs for a while. He talked about it at our first meeting, I think, when I was just running. And we can take that opportunity and move forward. So anyhow, I brought these with me. I spoke today to our chair of Ways and Means, who is Janet Ansel. She's from Calais, Vermont. And she's been someone who has not been supportive because she worries about the education fund. And so she told me that because the Senate passed this, she is willing to consider it and to possibly put our bill together with the Senate bill and then look at that as an overall sort of proposal. What was my hope? I'm not sure that this will happen this year, but we have 2 years. It's a biennium, so I have a feeling there'll be some testimony taken this year, and we may see it come back again next year. I mean, that's my honest opinion. I might be crazy. Who knows?
So Jessica, let me ask you, what would be helpful for the select board to do, if anything, right now, to provide support for you going back to say, look, the town of Shelburne is interested in encouraging the state of Vermont to provide municipalities with more economic incentive programs?
I think that this sort of statement would be great, but I honestly, the most important thing is to allow Joe to be able to come down and testify in support of something like this. I think that he wants to make sure that the select board is supportive of his being able to be helpful. And that's really, I mean, the committees like to hear from the real people. And so when you go there and you talk about why this is important, and I think that Route 7, those buildings, I mean, Joe and I talked about this the other day, that's a compelling argument. There it is. What are we going to do about those restaurants that are just, I mean, I came here this summer to hear some of the ideas that adult entertainment could move in, and those kinds of things are a little bit scary. So this would be another way to look at that and to look at some of that space. So
would you be supportive of if we considered a motion or a resolution encouraging the state of Vermont to provide municipalities with more economic development incentive options, including but not necessarily limited to TIFs, and to permit the town manager to go before the state legislature to testify in support of that motion?
Absolutely. Perfect.
So would somebody like to so move that?
I'd like to change it? I'd like to comment. First, note that John raises a very good point of credit risk. And if it were that we're dealing with a brownfields where you're putting on a $10 million project, you're putting $7 million of infrastructure, and proportionality is not a problem. But for us to put 70% on Route 7 is just not very likely in terms of, so the proportionality is going to be a problem. Second, I think our statement ought to favor Jessica's effort in committee now, which it names Shelburne.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Third, I think we ought to express solidarity with municipalities across the state in seeking a statutory change to relieve the restriction. And fourth, it seems to me there's a general opportunity, perhaps more than we had thought or wished, to make further statements of specific to other economic development initiatives that which may spring from this or which may get discussed because of this.
Right, absolutely. Thank you.
So I would favor the motion in front of us.
Do you have a motion in the second?
The motion that was provided by email today?
Yes.
Okay, and that, so people know what Jerry's referring to. It's consider a motion signaling the town of Shelburne's general support for tax increment financing districts as a tool that should be made available to Vermont municipalities as a way of generating economic development incentives and mutually beneficial public-private partnerships. This motion, that's at the end of it, this motion doesn't address Jessica's suggestion of authorizing Joe to appear to testify.
Oh, my understanding was that this would be an enablement.
It is. I mean, that's up to you all.
You would prefer language that...
I just want to make sure he feels comfortable. You don't have to have language in the piece.
I guess the only point, I wouldn't go down and testify on behalf of Shelburne in support of something like this if, in fact, the select board was not supportive of something like that.
Well,
so if you pass this,
so if you pass that, it would entail either me or a select board member or... Could go down and testify.
So you think this motion, though, is a little, it's geared towards TIFs, whereas the one Josh had mentioned before was geared towards...
I understand, but the legislation is proposed is geared toward TIFs.
It absolutely is.
So I'm seeking some consistency here without foreclosing on later statements of equal import regarding general economic development. Is that...
Yeah, I guess it is.
Does that make sense, Justin?
I mean, the bill that the Senate passed is, this bill proposes to authorize the Vermont Economic Progress Council to approve up to 2 tax increment financing districts per county in municipalities that do not currently have indebtedness for a district, subject to certain limitations and changes to the program for a 7-year period. So it is specific,
okay,
and then ours is specific to TIFs. But I don't think...
But it doesn't mention
Shelburne.
It's
totally up to you guys. Right. Ours does.
The House bill.
The one I
wrote. Yes, but the Senate one doesn't.
No.
Right.
The Senate
doesn't. Right. But they're going to put them together.
That's super. We're so fortunate to have you there.
Well, Kate has been great, too, I have to say. I'm new. I'm still learning, but I learned a lot on this and actually on H50 as well, which is a whole nother topic.
Does anyone else on the board have anything else on this they'd like to add?
Just that I think that, as far as either motion, I'm in support of either one in supporting you. as far as using a TIF here. And the reason I'm in support of that is I think that as much decision-making power should be given back to the local community as possible. Mm-hmm. And it allows us to at least make the decision for ourselves. Whether it's the right decision for Shelburne, I think I share the same reservations that everybody else has here, that I'm not sure if it's the right decision or not. And all of the cons seem to apply here, but I'm at least interested in us being able to make the decision ourselves.
Okay. I'm very interested in that also. What I'm concerned about this motion, Jerry, is, and maybe you can talk me out of it, is that this motion signals the town of Shelburne's general support for TIFs. And I'm not sure that I'm ready to go there, which is why when Josh made a suggestion before, I thought that made sense. And the way I incorporated TIFs into it was a way to try to combine both of them together. But
I think it's too timid. Would you not support a TIF for Bennington?
I wouldn't even enter into a discussion of that for Bennington.
I don't know. I think the solidarity among municipalities is pretty important here. I mean, we're dealing with a legislature that's made its own decisions about.
Yeah, and that's the part I agree with you wholeheartedly. Yeah. I do want the municipalities to have the ability to do it. I also know that many TIFs in the state of Vermont have failed. And
well, now the record doesn't show that.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. I thought the record in Winooski in particular shows that the state had to step up to the plate.
Only the Burlington one is getting close to its 20-year time to stop being able to not pay their thing. But
it's fair to say that the history of Vermont has been
not
100% positive. But that is not to say that it cannot be improved in the future, and that is also not to say that at least municipalities shouldn't have some more say in whether or not they apply within their boundaries.
I want to give Jerry a lot of credit. He reached out to try to get something on the agenda in regard to economic incentives. So I'm with you 100% on that.
Yeah, I can understand. I can understand. I mean, unfortunately, we're directing the comment toward existing proposed legislation, which kind of circumscribes it. On the other hand, I sense this general agreement among all of us about the benefits of economic development initiatives that we may take along with other municipalities in the state. So I'm okay. I think the discussion should be encouraging to you and confirm our interest.
And I think the committee that's going to hear this is going to be Ways and Means, and they are very concerned about economic development. They're not super supportive of TIFs. They're sort of in the middle, too.
Yeah.
So the type of thing you're all talking about fits perfectly.
Yeah.
And I think that Joe could go and actually read it, which would be kind of nice.
Last word. But it rests on local control.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
If we do an EDC, it has to be
It has to be your choice.
And our locality.
Absolutely.
And the issue here is locality and local control.
Right.
To me, that's the policy issue. So
I
respectfully understand and agree with your point of view, and I'm okay with that. So
if the motion I said earlier, would that be something you would, if I can remember it? Which I think it was consider a motion encouraging the state of Vermont to provide, and let's add, Shelburne and other municipalities more economic development incentive options, including but not necessarily limited to TIFs, and to authorize Joe to appear before the legislature to testify.
Moved
by Jerry, seconded by Colleen. Anyone here have anything they'd like to add about this? Anyone else on the board, anything?
No. That's good.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so it passes.
Thanks so much.
Thank you very much, Jessica.
It should actually probably be reassuring to the committee that even at the local level, it's, you know, there's hesitation and thought.
All right. Next up, one of the most exciting times of the year.
We've all been waiting.
Really? Bated breath. Number 8. Review and consider accepting the fiscal year 2016 financial audit from Sullivan Powers and Company. And I'm going to have Joe introduce our auditor and to give a little intro and maybe a little summary about the how the audit turned out.
Sure. Real quick, I think it's fair to say, and I don't want to steal our auditor's thunder, that the town is in excellent financial health. A lot of credit to the select board, certainly, for leadership on this. Peter Frankenberg individually, who kind of lives and breathes this every day and takes care of us. But I do think that overall what the audit shows is that the town is in excellent financial health. There's no doubt about that. One thing I want to make clear is this board went to Sullivan Powers, I think, 2 years ago. And one of the reasons that we picked them is because we know, and this was actually Peter's recommendation, we didn't pick the firm that we thought was going to be easy on us. We picked the firm that we knew had a track record of being, I'll say harsh critics, but a good critic of how municipalities are operating. And so, you know, there are certainly some areas and recommendations that our auditors provided us, but we wanted them specifically for that reason, to have someone who was going to give us pointers. And Peter will be able to go over with you. You know, they gave us a number of recommendations last year. Certainly, we did not meet all of them, but we did make some headway and significant headway on a number of them. So it's not like, well, we just looked at places for improvement and put them on the shelf and scrapped them. We made conscious efforts to try to better ourselves, better the way we do business. And again, a lot of credit to Peter and the entire board and everyone on staff for a very successful audit. There's no doubt about it. And I think maybe I'll turn it over to Peter to go from there.
Just in terms of, I mean, really there's two things you're looking for in an audit. One thing is a clean audit, and the auditor says that your financials represent the true position of the town. That's goal number one. I think Sullivan Powers and Rick and his staff bring, as Joe mentioned, a lot of value to their engagement because they do a number of municipal audits, probably one of the biggest firms in the state that does municipal audits. And they bring recommendations with it, how they see things. And it doesn't necessarily mean we have to do them, but they provide that as background for us and suggestions. In some cases, they do see weaknesses that require a written response from us, and you'll see those in there. As Joe said, for me personally, obviously the list is longer than I'd like it to be, but at the same time, I can't argue with anything that's in there, and we will certainly work towards accomplishing some of those things. One of the big changes from last year that we did, we have all the special funds that Rick will probably get into, and I think every audit letter we got said, we've gotten previously said, it would really be nice if you could really split those out on your books so that the auditor doesn't have to crawl through and put them into different categories, that they can just have it when they show up. It's all separated out, things like the ambulance fund, the police cruiser fund, tree funds. We've got funds and funds of things that are accounted for separately every year. And they really weren't very clearly outlined when the auditors came on site, and they kind of had to pull and pick things apart, I think. So this past year, again, with guidance from them about how to set it up, we were able to do that. And I think it does make it a lot clearer for the committees and whoever has those special funds to see what their revenues, expenses, and all of that are. A little bit hard to do before. So that was one, I think, major accomplishment that we did this last year. And other things like that we may not, that we're probably doing that weren't really highlighted because we weren't documenting them very well, but certainly electronic transfers of funds. Our banking system does require two people to do that, but we didn't necessarily document who was doing that. So we're trying to make a better effort to leave a trail of those kinds of tasks that we do that where you really need to have a trail of in terms of who approved it and that there was more than one pair of eyes looking at it. So just those are my general comments, and it's really Rick's role to now talk about, you know, what he sees for the financial results and where we go from here. But they've been a very good firm to work with. We knew they were going to be tough in terms of looking at things, and they haven't hesitated to do that, but I think it's been very positive. The staff has worked with us instead of just sort of accusing us of things and saying and sort of scolding us. It's been a very positive experience, and we've got one more year to go, and hopefully that'll
more
be better
than that,
from there.
Rick, thank you very much. Thanks for the report itself. It was quite a, I thought it was a great report.
Thank you. I just wanted to take a few minutes kind of to sort of walk you through the report. I mean, Joe and Peter have kind of given you a really good, quick outline that they've actually, they did steal my thunder because they actually gave you a lot of the stuff that I was going to go over. First off, all I really want to go over in a little bit of detail is the audit report itself, the thick document. And if we could just kind of, if we can go right to page one, page one is the audit opinion. That is really the one document within this whole audit report that is mine. That was my charge to come to say, my job is to come up to an opinion on your financial statements. Everything else, as you look at the document, we helped Peter and his staff prepare this report. We did assist them in disclosures and things like that, but in what drives the mechanisms to get it there, all the work that goes in throughout the year, whether it's approving contracts, paying bills, receipts, new grants, revenues, all the postings that relate to all that activity throughout the year, Peter and his staff have done a wonderful job in putting the stuff together to bring that to a good financial report. So, you know, when you, everybody always says, oh, geez, we need to find a lot of report to really look at the numbers. The truth is, he's got the numbers. The numbers are always there, and you've been looking at them on a pretty regular basis, probably in your, whether it's quarterly financials or monthly financials that you get. My job was just to come in as the year-end, help them put the audit report together, the financial statement, and then come up with the opinion. When you have an audit opinion, you have three choices. You could have an adverse opinion, which says these financial statements are not fairly stated. Simple as that. Or you could have a qualified, say they might be good except for one thing within the financial statements, or there's an unqualified. That's the best you can have. I'm not going to say that this was an easy audit, and I don't think Peter would say it was an easy audit, but you did get an unqualified opinion, and that doesn't come without a lot of work. As I was sitting here preparing for the, or this morning preparing for the board, I was thinking, I was reading through the financials, I was thinking, how do I summarize into 15 minutes all the work that went into this, whether it was Joe, Peter, my staff, or all the time that we started probably in early summer, right up through probably till a couple weeks ago. And it's just amazing that, you know, one of the things I really wanted to point out is that this was a particularly difficult audit, only because I think Shelburne Finance was a little short-staffed this year. They were down a person, and you could tell when we came in that that seemed to be an issue. But what I really got is the rest of Peter's staff, along with them, picked up the ball and just knew things had to get done. And I think there was a lot of late nights to get that done and in order to get you the reports. But again, getting to that unqualified opinion, I want to congratulate the town for that. You know, like I said, not all those audit reports I do a lot of them. Not all of them get that unqualified opinion, and so I wanted to thank Peter and Joe and the staff for everything they did to get us there. So, in looking at the audit report, the other things I wanted to look at, pages 4 through 12, that's called the management's discussion analysis. If you looked at nothing else in the audit report, if you wanted a good consolidation of what's going on in the audit report, look at those pages. It's a very user-friendly document put together by Joe and Peter to kind of say what happened during the year. We've looked at it, we've analyzed, made sure there's no real factual errors in it. And so, but what I like about that document is it becomes really user-friendly, not a lot of accounting jargon in it, it's simplified. So I would suggest if you were trying to find, you know, within the numbers, the nuts and bolts, look at those pages and you'll get a really good outline of what happened during the year. If we look at page 13, this is the statement of net position for the town. The statement of net position basically is the old balance sheet, what people used to refer as the balance sheet. What are all your assets and liabilities of the town? You break it into two really fun types, your water and sewer, which are your enterprise funds, and then everything else that you have rolls up into the governmental activities column that we have here. That means all the reappraisal reserves, all the other, the ambulance, the highway, the town general fund, all that along with fixed assets, along with all the debt related to all that, is all rolled up into that balance sheet as of June 30, 2016. if we look at that, if you look at the bottom, that's really what most people will focus on, is the unrestricted net assets in the governmental section would be $1,462,280. That's up from $1,399,639 from last year. So again, up, you know, about $63,000. One of the things you'll notice is that when we break out in the net position, we look at the, there's something called net investment in capital assets. We don't want you to be thinking your fund balance is, you know, $11 million when most of it is tied up into fixed assets. So we break out that piece so that you understand that when you're looking at those net assets, a lot of those are capital infrastructure that aren't really current assets. So we like to make sure that people are aware of that. If we move over to page 15, and I'm going to kind of whip through some of this relatively quickly, but the major fund of your, of the town of Shelburne is the general fund. If you're looking at the general fund, the one thing, that, as Peter said, you if you look page 15, three quarters of the way down, the unassigned fund balance is about $555,926. Last year was about $547,503. So not significantly different from where you were last year. People focus on that number because really that's the number that people will look at for determining if they're going to use it to offset taxes, if they have enough fund balance to for reserves or for emergencies, things like that. I think you're sitting with, my quick calculation in my head here is I think you're sitting about 6-8% of your budget is sitting in fund balance. That's not bad. As Peter and Joe both said, fairly healthy. Now, GFOA would stay, tell you that probably it would be better to be closer to 10, 15, maybe even 20%, just because of so many things can happen and you can eat into reserves relatively quickly. So a lot of Vermont communities don't really have the kind of resources to get there, or if they are, they're slowly getting there and building there, building fund balance policies to get to them, to those points. But I will say that I think right now, you're not in a deficit. You have some money there that you're able to use for cash flow needs. So again, I agree with Joe and Peter. That's a pretty healthy fund balance. One of the other items I wanted to talk about is if you look at page 18, which would be the balance sheet for the water and sewer. As I was preparing this morning, one of the things I just wanted to point out, when I look at the water fund unrestricted net assets, that's the only thing that just sort of jumped out at me a little bit to say, it's only about 39,000. That's pretty tight as far as that as far as net assets goes. I think last year was about 95,000. It dropped about 60, you know, dropped.
I think it dropped the amount of a lot of water breaks on Spear Street.
Right. And that was where I was actually going through the notes this morning. I was like, there was one line item in the budget actual, and it was related to the water breaks. It obviously made a tough year for you guys. But it was something that, as you're looking at water rates, as you're thinking whether you have enough reserves, are you thinking about, you know, increasing water rates? And, you know, meanwhile, the sewer has a very healthy fund balance. So I know some communities, if they have the same water and sewer users, might think of shifting the rate so the overall rate doesn't go up, but you could shift one, lower the sewer to raise the water, just so that you can increase the fund balances. It's just an idea, but it just one of the things when I was looking at it, it just seemed a little tight, because the rest of your fund balances within all the small funds look pretty good. There are no deficits there to cover. There's no major problems or concern areas, but in the water and sewer, those are ones I just wanted to point out there.
Just so you know, not all our water users are sewer users.
Okay.
Not all, so.
That's why that sometimes can be an issue.
And also, sorry, to be fair, we have a separate water commission that's responsible for the water budget, which is separate from this group of governing body, which is responsible for the general fund and the sewer fund. Certainly don't mean to throw our one water commissioner under the bus, but it is a separate separate governing body that is in charge of the water fund.
Looking at pages 21 through 50, I just wanted to point out what those are. Those are the notes to the financial statements. If you're looking at any of the detail, you want to know what makes up some of the receivables, what are the cash balances, are they FDIC insured, what are the terms of all the notes we have, the debt out there. That would all be covered in those notes to the financial statements. Again, a lot of pages. I'm not going to get into the details of that, but I did want to let you know what those were. Schedule one is basically your budget actual for your general fund. That you've probably been used to seeing all year long. I'm not going to go into it. You pretty much have a pretty good idea of, you know, obviously the big thing was legal expenses this year. That was one of the things that was pointed out, and I've heard it in read it in minute meetings and heard it tonight. That was obviously a big cost to the town. But overall, like I said, as far as the budget actual, if we look at the last page, you know, your excess revenues over expenses is about $10,000. So pretty tight, but right there, you know, pretty much well in line with what you budgeted. Maybe not category by category, but in total, a very good job. So going to the back of the report, I'm just going to get into the findings real quick. Peter kind of mentioned them already a little bit. One of the things we want to make sure, if you look at...
Which page are you on?
We're on page 75.
Thank you.
75 and 76 are really about segregation of duties and making sure that when you're reconciling bank statements and signing checks, that we're having different people perform those functions. We really don't want somebody reconciling who has check signing authority or who has ACH ability. And that's where people sometimes lose track of that. They say, oh, I don't have check signing, but they have ACH. So within those 2 points, what we're trying to do is point out, okay, let's just set up some controls in place to make sure somebody's reconciling, but they have nothing to do with releasing money, writing checks, signing checks, things like that. And so it's our way to kind of point out those items to you. And I think, have those already been fixed, Peter, at this point?
Not quite.
Okay. We had talked about hopefully getting this done before the end of this fiscal year and having all that done. Number three, we just thought it was a really good idea. RecTrack tracks all your recreation activities. It's a separate general ledger system. We thought it would be really good to have at least a monthly or quarterly review of the RecTrack numbers and comparing them to the general ledger related to the numbers that are in Peter's accounting system. So we recommended that that reconciliation happen, if not monthly, quarterly. And I think that, if I'm not mistaken, has already been taken care of at this point. And the last thing, item as far as the deficiencies I wanted to go over tonight was review and approval of journal entries. Again, during the year, a lot of activity happens, a lot of payments, a lot of grants coming in. There's all sorts of journal entries, booking receivables, payables. All those things, when somebody is changing an account balance or reclassifying it, we would like somebody who's preparing those journal entries to give them to somebody else for review to make sure they're accurate, to make sure that the journal entries make sense. And so that's one of the things, you know, everybody's very good about approving warrants and getting receipts that when money's coming in the door. But this is something that changes within that system, and we're just suggesting when something changes with it, let's make sure there's another pair of eyes on it as well. And so, again, that's just one of our final thoughts on that, was that having somebody double-check that and make sure that they're signed off as well would be a good idea. I have issued another report, which you have in front of you. I'm not going to get into it. Again, this is the management letter. A lot of people refer to it as the management letter. It's going to have the findings we just talked about, but it's also going to have what we call other recommendations. Those are things like Joe and Peter noted to you. When we're here, we're going to suggest everything to you. We're going to tell you all the things that we think, hey, this might be a good idea. And we're going to put them in writing. And so within there, like Peter said, a few of these have been already addressed. Some of them will be addressed before the year end. But my goal, by the end of the 3 years here, one way or another, we're going to make sure that none of these exist anymore. Or if they have, that we found other ways to deal with them. And so that's kind of what Peter and I have talked at length about many times, is trying to make sure that over the three-year cycle that we can get rid of a lot of these points and really work to getting to not only a clean opinion, but a clean management letter as well.
I really had. You flew through.
What's that?
you flew through 81 pages.
I did.
No, it's 78.
I knew I had 15 minutes. I don't know if anybody had any questions or anything they wanted.
Turn it over to the board and then to anyone else. Anybody have any questions or comments other than great work?
No, I'll second that. It was very thorough. I actually enjoyed reading every bit of it to, you know, come up to the same conclusion that you did. And I think that the way you packaged it certainly, you know, allowed a layman to understand it and to, you know, feel pretty good about sitting on this side of the table and knowing we've done, as a group, a collective good job here to manage the town. So,
absolutely.
Thank you very much for those words.
Yeah, we really appreciate it because, let's face it, the budget is the big ticket item. And to hear from our independent auditor that the town is in excellent financial health and that town staff has done a great job and the board has worked well to
get us there.
To get us there, that's very nice to hear. So thank you, Rick.
Absolutely.
And it's always nice to have like outside validation that the staff and the people that do this on a day-to-day basis really know what they're doing and do it well. And and that the suggestions that are offered are reasonable and make sense.
Right. Yeah. And one of my big things, you know, and I've kind of talked a little bit about it was, is that I'm hoping that Peter and his staff will be fully, you know, fully staffed. I think I've read in the minutes where they're still looking or they might be still short, but hopefully when that happens, a lot of the recommendations we've talked about can, somebody will have time to get on those. Because I know, like I said, I know Peter's doing a lot of other different jobs that he wasn't doing before, and it's taking up a lot of time.
Rick, so. I think our proposed budget, if it passes, which I hope it does, but provides for an additional 20 hours per week for the finance department?
30 hours.
All right, so we should have, you know, some more help. You know, there was talk before about trying to get even more, but that's what we ended up at.
Right.
So let's, hopefully that'll be helpful.
And one of the things we're trying to work with Peter on is try to find the efficiencies as well. Because, you know, there's obviously a lot of stuff that, you know, they could use bodies for and things like that to get some of the work done. But there's some of the things like his consolidation of the funds and breaking those out that will automatically start saving time for Peter now and hopefully, you know, be able to do some other different tasks and resort the deck, so to speak. So looking forward to keeping over the next year and a half, looking at those efficiencies for him and his staff as well, because I know budgets are tight. I mean, I'd love to be able to say he could use two more people, but I understand that budgets are tight. And we'll certainly do our part to help you look at any efficiencies we can find.
Thank you. You guys have anything you want to add?
Yeah, I've got a couple of comments.
Sure.
First, congratulations, Peter. This is not automatic.
Right.
Congratulations to you. I think that the presentation is exceptional. If it was in last year's audit, I either wasn't paying attention or was unable to absorb it. But I think the distinction between governmental funds and proprietary funds is really instructive and useful.
Good, good. Mm-hmm.
And oddly, not oddly, but interestingly, when you go to the asset sheets, the balance of assets is just about 50-50 between those two, you know, the entrepreneurial funds and the regular, which is kind of an interesting comment.
It is.
On where the town's assets are.
Right, exactly.
Especially as we approach stormwater.
Right, right.
And I had a couple of comments on page 11. It was wonderful to see the pay down of $1.3 million in debt. On page 12, I've commented before, a number of us have, that the $7 million project figure does not include monitoring, maintenance, transactional costs, and probably should be 10.
And you're talking about stormwater.
Yeah, stormwater. And on, and the last is to thank Paul Goodrich profusely for his help this year.
Thanks, Jerry. Josh, did you have anything you want to add?
I don't think I can be as excited as John was about the 3 or 4 hours I spent reading the report. I can't say it was the the most entertaining this time I've spent, but I
there's do, always one person.
No. But I will be incredibly appreciative and applauding of how it was put together. I found it really instructive. I found it very educational. I think it will help a lot. Sort of my understanding of the budget process next year. I agree with Jerry that, you know, setting the two, sort of the government versus the business, or the tax side versus the fee side,
yep,
was really helpful.
Yep.
And I think that if you look at into the details of that, you can really see where the spending or the overspending, you know, where things and how that all thing out. So I think that was, I think the whole thing was put together really nicely for someone who's not used to reading audits.
Great.
And so I think that's a good
thing.
That
says a lot right there, actually.
Yeah. And the other thing that I talked about with Peter this afternoon, and I think it follows up on your goal to, at the end of next year, not have everything, is the possibility that we can actually, in addition to the quarterly budget report, sort of have an update of where we are on addressing some of the deficiencies. And I think
idea.
that way helps us not know that it's not getting lost in the shuffle, so to speak.
Great idea.
So that's all I have to say.
Thank you. Did a great job. Anyone else want to read the entire audit report, translate it into Russian or something for us? Anyone have any comments? Hi, Joe.
Yeah, just one last thing. Again, you know, we're going to spend 30 minutes on this document, and we've probably spent 2 or 3 hours, if not more, on other things throughout the year, and this is probably one of the most significant things, if not the most significant action that this board is going to take all year, accepting the audit. When you're on a board of directors of a municipal corporation or any corporation, this is one of your fundamental responsibilities to the corporation and to the citizens here of Shelburne. And there's been at times some disagreements among board members and amongst others, but I hope that the five of you feel really good about the team effort that was put forth to having such a well put together audit. Certainly Peter deserves a lot of credit for his work in doing this year understaffed. But really it is a tribute to everyone here, the entire community, that we have such strong financials. And thank you to the board for, you know, allowing staff to do our work and to do it to the best of our ability. And hopefully this shows that we're serving you well. And also I would say to, as Josh was saying, it is an informative document and it is online for people to review. And I would encourage people in Shelburne to take, if not 4 hours, maybe at least an hour to go through it, because you do learn a lot about town operations. It is an enlightening document. And so I would recommend folks to do that. And thank you again to the board for allowing us to present you this.
Thanks, Joe, it's nice to hear. And Rick, so you know, the general idea and thought in Shelburne is we have a superstar in Peter Frankenberg.
Absolutely. We have that same thought.
All right, so would someone like to make a motion accepting the fiscal year 2016 audit from the town auditors?
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Colleen, seconded by Josh, a quarter of a second before Jerry. See, Alabama lost in the last second, so.
Still trying to deal with
it. Yeah, it's a big Alabama fan. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you very much, Rick.
Thanks.
Very professional. Just great job.
Have a safe trip back.
All right, next item is item number 9. Consider accepting zoning bylaw amendments from the Planning Commission and consider warning a public hearing for April 11th, one day after the Yankee home opener, 2017.
You'll be back.
I'll be back then.
It's flag football.
Oh. All right, the digs are going. All right, so why don't I turn this over to Dean or Joe, or how do you want to?
I can do it real quick. So
okay.
Whenever the Planning Commission approves amendments for select board consideration, the first thing you need to do is accept them. That's what we're going to do tonight. Dean can give you a short synopsis of the proposals.
And then we need to set a public hearing date so that we have enough time to warn for it properly and prepare and whatnot. So I think I can turn over to Dean and he can review, I think at least give you a general overview of the proposals that have been passed forward from the Planning Commission.
Mr. Pierce.
With your approval, everyone should have a copy of the proposal in their packets. My apologies to people in the audience. I do not have paper copies with me, but the proposal is on the town's website. If you go to the planning and zoning page of the website, on the left-hand side, there's a zoning updates section that will take you right to the proposal. So what I'm going to do, are the lights okay? Do we want to step them down by half or?
Yeah, Nora, could you just turn one of those things down?
Thank you, Peter. The Planning Commission has been working through a list of possible zoning changes since early last year. They've been working on zoning changes consistently, but they've had a concentrated effort. The list that they've been working through is one that was developed after the commission itself identified some of its priorities. It also incorporates some of the suggestions or ideas of the members of the Development Review Board. The commission has, like I said, since May, been working through that list. They got to a point where they felt like they had enough material to put it together and move it to a hearing process. They felt like if they waited too much longer, there would be too much time since they started on some things and they wouldn't really remember what all the rationale was. So this is a package. It doesn't really have a consistent theme, but it's more efficient to do it this way than to try to hold hearings essentially every couple of meetings.
Thank you.
Yes, and I thank them. The proposal affects four articles, or what you could think of as chapters within the regulations. A lot of the material that is changed is in Article 19, which is the general regulation section. The zoning regulations have a lot of the articles that are specific or that relate to the individual districts on the map. And then there's this big article, 19, which is the general regulations that has sections or has language that applies across the board. The proposal would also modify some of the definitions or add some definitions. That is the Article 21. That's the last. This is simply a list of those articles. If you really were interested, this is included in the material that's on the website. Breaking it down a little bit, recognizing the lack of time or the limited time, the topics that are covered within this particular set of proposed changes include material related to sidewalks and paths, trailers and storage, sign lighting, setbacks from private rights of way, because that isn't something that's explicitly incorporated in the regulations right now, and excavation and fill. And what I'm going to do right now is blast through in bullet form the essence of those changes in those topic areas. Under sidewalks and paths, there's language that they've incorporated, and I've borrowed it because I think it conveys that their overall intention is to promote multimodal connectivity within sites, between adjacent or adjoining sites, and neighborhoods, and to transit and public roads. The Planning Commission really wants this aspect of our transportation system to be enhanced. The way that they do this is by modifying the site plan regulations, the requirements in that. That's section 1900. It would, more specifically, expand some application requirements. The person who's doing a project would need to provide a bit more information, a narrative material, a plan, a drawing. The proposal would also expand some of the review standards, the things that the Development Review Board, I think there's one DRB member here, but the things that Mark and his colleagues apply to a proposal, so are the sidewalks adequate to accommodate the traffic from the development and so forth. And there's also a text and a table that spells out by district or by groups of districts what types of facilities are expected. And we could talk about that if there are questions. Under the trailers and storage part of the proposal, there would be some edits to a performance standards section, specifically some things having to do with solid waste. It would require screening or enclosure of some things that are already regulated by the bylaw, but we've had some situations where the question is, what's really meant by screening? How much screening is screening? This proposal would say that the screening needs to be complete, or the articles that are regulated need to be enclosed. There would also be an explicit statement of the need for permits for unregistered trailers that are used for storage. This is something that has been the practice of the town, and it's consistent with prior board rulings. It's supported by decisions and such, but it isn't actually spelled out. This proposal would add that language, so it's really bulletproof. The last point under this section is that it would establish permit requirements for portable storage containers that are used for extended periods of time. I want to make it clear that the proposal has allowances for short-term or kind of low-level use, but if someone was to be using storage containers extensively and for extended periods of time, then they would be subject to the regulations under this proposal. Sign lighting. This proposal would edit some of the sign lighting requirements. We have a sign section in the bylaw, and then a subsection of that has to do with the way that signs are lit. It gets into some kind of minutia. Some would think it has to do with the way that the lighting levels are measured. It tightens up some of the language having to do with how fixtures are aimed at the sign. It would explicitly prohibit sign lighting that causes glare. We've got a specific type of sign called a halo sign, and there's language about that. And then it would also have a schedule for the sign lighting. Right now, our zoning regulations say that you're supposed to turn off sign lights when a business closes. That isn't always the practice. The Planning Commission thought that it would be good to have some greater allowances. Some jurisdictions have a restriction for sign lighting, within a certain number of hours of closing, and that's something that this proposal does. Setbacks, rights of way, private rights of way. This proposal is really focused. It applies to one zoning district, the residential zoning district, and it adds a definition, because in the zoning regulations, we don't have a definition of street. And then within that one district, it looks at private rights of way and puts them in two camps, okay? And we have a pre-1970s camp or category, and a 1970s and after category. And just to put it simply, if it's a private right of way in the residential district after 1970, it gets treated like a private street, a 30-foot front yard setback. If it's older, then we have a different approach. And it sets up whichever is less standard, and essentially provides for a reduced front yard setback requirement that's either measured from the edge, if you can measure from the edge, or from the center. In any event, if you can measure from the center or from the edge, whichever one is the least encroachment, that's the one that you have to meet. Okay. But right now, we don't have anything explicit about that. Excavation and fill. This would change some of the requirements that are found towards the end of the bylaw. It's called special zoning permits. It would change the trigger for when permits are required. Going back many, many years ago, the trigger for an excavation and fill permit, we were advised by council, it could be a wheelbarrow. Technically, that might have triggered the need. The zoning regs were changed to make it area-based, 1,000 square feet, or more recently, it was changed to be 500 square feet within the lakeshore setback. The proposal would add a volume element. So it says, or would say, that you can fill 499 square feet or 999. If you get to 1,000, but you have used less than 8 cubic yards, well, then you don't trigger the need for the permit. But if you do 8 cubic yards, you do trigger. So we would get away from a situation where someone could put a very thin layer of fill or do a thin excavation, and that would trigger the need for a permit. 8 cubic yards is proposed as the threshold. It clarifies some references to manuals that are cited in the regulations, and it gives certain sort of like waiver authority to the water quality superintendent when it comes to excavation and fill. I can give you more details if you want them.
No. We're just accepting it today.
Just in terms of process for people, Planning Commission warns a public hearing. After they hold the hearing, they move it to the select board. Select board schedules its hearing, and if you hold the hearing and if you were to act on it and approve it, it takes 21 days before it takes effect, although it could be changed, and if you change it, as you know, the board knows, you'd have to warn another hearing.
All right. Does someone have any comments, questions? Or we're, again, tonight we're just accepting this and scheduling a public hearing. So, but go ahead, please.
No, I just have a question, just because I suspect if people see this, this is a question they're going to ask. Is there an easy place to go look to see if their development is pre-1970 or post-1970? Because that might influence their...
That's a good question. No, I wouldn't say that there's an easy way, but I will endeavor to, I'll work with someone like Lisa Mann, and I think that she might be the best person in the building to help come up with a list so that people call, but it's not something that I have a comprehensive list.
Okay, because I think that would be, that was the first question I looked at.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I will say that when the Planning Commission worked on this, and I don't know if any of them have crept into the room since we started, the Planning Commission did do some, I'll call them case studies, where we looked at some of the private rights of way and saw the implication, and that's what helped them come up with the numbers that they ended up proposing. Okay.
All right, any other comments? Anyone here have any comments?
I've got a
comment. Oh, please.
I was honored to serve on the DRB when a number of these issues were identified, and this to me is an outstanding example of with what efficiency and professionalism town staff has applied themselves to take some problems that were identified by the DRB. Phil, I remember public storage containers that were real problems that came up during applications being reviewed. And here we are in roughly 2 years later with a near finished product that addresses those situations and corrects them or remediates them. And I think it's a wonderful testament to the effectiveness dedication of town staff, and in particular Dean. This is a journey that we're only a small part of, in effect, and we're toward the end, but we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that this is a long, several-year effort, and by all accounts, reading through the first time has been done exceptionally well.
We do have an exceedingly strong Planning Commission right now, and part of what you were talking about really is reflective of the changes that the board initiated 3 years ago in fostering dialogues between different boards. So the DRB and the Planning Commission could talk back and forth. This was part of our changeover to being open and transparent. It's been very successful, as demonstrated by this document.
Yeah, this is a wonderful example of that.
So all right, so I just congrats. Have one other comment. There was an agenda item in the last year that there was some question as to whether there was appropriate public warning, and that it was, and this reminds me of that there's a lot of things in here that somebody who looks at an agenda item just sees zoning bylaw amendments, doesn't see exactly what they are. And the only one that really stands out to me is the sign lighting, and whether businesses in town who have an interest in this would see this on the agenda and know that this might be one of them and might have some input about it. So is there, I don't know, some way to kind of piece it out a little bit more so people have a little bit more warning if they want to have input?
Well, I would say that Joe's manager report, a couple, maybe the last one, next to last, had a fairly detailed explanation of what the changes were. That isn't necessarily everyone. It's only the people that read Front Porch Forum. I'm open to any suggestions for this or how it gets put on your agenda. We can't change how it was.
Well, Colleen makes a great point. Mm-hmm. You know, our goal is to have agenda items that are sufficient to provide everyone in town notice of what we're going to discuss, and we do our best to do that. Joe does a great job. In this case, you make a great point, is that the annotated agenda that accompanies the agenda includes the summary that we have right in our hands, for sidewalks and sign lighting and setbacks and excavation and, yeah, and all those, yeah, other things. So I encourage everyone, if anyone's listening, you know, the 4 million people, to please click on the agenda item, and you'll see the materials that accompany them, so you can get all these details. You make another great point. So thanks,
yeah, for, yeah, that is a great point. If we had keyword identification, just, mm-hmm, lighting and fill,
yeah,
and
that's what, yeah, I'm thinking.
Storage, like, you trailers, and, you know, that, I think, yeah, that's a really well taken point.
I will say that the Planning Commission's agenda for the meeting at which they had their public hearing, it did not necessarily use these exact same words, but it did identify the range of areas with words like those.
I think we can try to do some creative marketing between now and April 11th to make sure that as many people are aware of this as possible.
Right.
Work with Shelburne News and others.
All right. Would someone like to make a motion?
So moved.
Move to formally receive the proposed amendments from the Planning Commission and set a public hearing for April 11th, 2017. I believe it was what Jerry was moving.
Yes.
Second.
Yes. I could just tell my soul moved. And seconded by Colleen. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Great.
Thank
Dean.
You,
really well
Thank
done.
You,
a plus, buddy.
Thanks, Dean.
Thanks. Mm-hmm. All right. Next up. Oh, yes. I love this committee. Consider accepting the tree management plan as proposed by the Tree Advisory Committee. And we have Gail Henderson King. Hello, Gail.
I think a number of the Tree Advisory Committee.
And we have a whole bunch of...
Yeah, we have several people. Holden Johnson's here. David Hall, who's also our tree warden.
And Anne, however you say her last name, I can never say it, is
Perfect.
Here.
Chicken.
And perfect. Can I just say that your costume was the best costume my 8 years on this board I have ever seen when you showed up in the tree. That was spectacular.
It's a high standard, yes.
So, Gail, let me turn it right over to you.
Okay, sure. So, just to give you a quick background on this, the town received a grant from the Vermont Urban and Community Forestry Program starting back, 2014, to do a tree inventory, do some training on tree pruning, tree management, and then also do a tree management plan. So the inventory was done of most of Shelburne Village back, it was finished in 2014. We had the tree training happened in the summer of 2015. Joe was there as well as several staff people and several people from our committee. And then last year, in 2015 and 16, we worked on finalizing the tree management plan with help from Chittenden County Regional Planning Commission staff, Lee Crone. So we actually brought this to you back in August of 2016 when we came for our final update as to what we've been doing for the year, but we never officially got you to accept it. So we're back here to have you officially accept it because we're in the process of implementing this. It's got some guidelines for what we want to do over the next 4 years. It's really, you know, it's a pretty loose guideline, but we have started to implement some of these things. We have been working, as you know, with the Recreation Commission on Shelburne Beach and some of the other park properties, as well as we've been doing work on the Village Green and the Parade Ground in terms of maintenance issues and new plantings. So it's really just a general guideline. It talks about the existing conditions right now, gives some general pruning and maintenance guidelines for what we really want to have town staff help with when they're involved with any tree maintenance and tree removal within the public rights of way or on town property, and then also some long-term goals that are outlined in it. So I don't know if you have any questions on it, but that's really why we're here, is we just, it never got officially accepted. And before you all leave, which hopefully you won't, but if you do, we'd like, you all are familiar with this, we'd like to be able to get it accepted and be able to move on, so.
Well, Gail, you had me at hello. So, anyone have any questions, or anyone else from the tree committee want to say anything?
Say if anybody wants to.
In no particular order?
Can I say something?
Sure,
I
please.
I didn't okay this with the group, though, before I came here.
Well, you're sometimes fine. You got to live on the edge.
I'm going to live on the edge. You can hear me, right? Okay. This I'm Hope Johnson, and I reviewed this plan. I didn't have anything to do with this plan because I'm a newbie on the committee. But one word I did see in here was stormwater, and the trees provide a great way to mitigate stormwater.
Yes.
So I'd like just to remind you that that is a consideration that's pretty important. And I think the figure in here is about $5,000 annually to somehow mitigate a cost for stormwater runoff. So just something I wanted to bring up.
It's a great point, Hope. It's something that we've had charrettes for a long time about form-based code, and one of the things that came up was stormwater. Mm-hmm. And Kate Lally on the Planning Commission has referred to it as low-lying fruit that the town can address by the more planting of trees. The mitigation effect from stormwater is dramatic. So it's something that I think everyone on this board is aware of, and I know we've had conversations about it, and the Planning Commission's aware of it too. I think it's a great point. Anyone else on the board would like to say something? From the committee, I mean. Anyone on this board like to say anything about this?
I'm good.
Thank you so much for all the work you guys do. And would someone like to make a motion to make Gail happy?
Yes, I'll move to accept the public tree and street tree management plan officially.
Moved by Colleen Parker.
Second.
Seconded by Jerry Story. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you very much, Gail.
Thank you.
All right, our next item is item number 11. Consider signing an agreement with the state of Vermont for the Village Railroad parking lot lease. This is an item that has been on for discussion with, is this something? You gonna recuse yourself?
No, I'm not. I've looked over the material, and from my understanding, this is something that is an agreement between the state and the town, and I don't see the overlap. So unless you can demonstrate where that overlap is,
it is
I don't
something
believe
that's
it.
Come up during the litigation talks. I'm gonna leave it up to you.
No, I don't believe I had, there's a rationale there.
Okay, anyone else? Okay, so this is for the parking lot here. The state provided a proposed lease for this. It had onerous terms. It was unacceptable to the board as it was discussed, and with town staff, the town attorney took a look at it. The craft school has been involved in this, and frankly, I can tell you, personally, I'm one person of five, but I would suggest, I would speculate that everyone on the board agrees that we want to do whatever we can to help the craft school here. We have proposed an additional provision for this lease that would provide the town with an opt-out because of all the onerous terms that are in there. Preliminarily, we have, town staff has heard that it looks promising that it will be accepted by the state. And if that is the case, then I would be supportive of it. Everyone else, of course, would make up their own mind. But at this time, we were hoping to get confirmation as late as today. It didn't come today. So I think if I have this right, Joe, that we would your staff is recommending we put this off until the next meeting, and hopefully we will have the state's approval by that time, and it can be considered by the whole board. Is that a fair?
Yeah, I think you nailed the crux of it. You know, I've been working on this lease for over a year now with the state, also with Shelburne Community School, our state representatives, a local individual in Shelburne who has been a liaison between me and the state, who worked for V-Trans during his career, so he kind of knows the players. So we have an all-hands-on-deck attitude here. I believe it's promising, the indication, like Gary has said, that the state is going to be amenable to the opt-out clause language that the town has suggested. Even with that language, I would say it's a pretty one-sided lease agreement in favor of the state, but I would be comfortable presenting it to the board for approval if that opt-out clause can be put into the lease. And again, at least the indication from the state is they would be amenable to it. So I would recommend at this point to table this at least until the next meeting and hopefully have an agreement that we can look at.
And we have, so people know, I've been in contact with the craft school. I've personally spoken with Stephen Salin, who's been, I believe he's on the board there. I've also, Sage has been involved in email discussions, and Lisa Winkler also, I've spoken with her about it. So they're well aware of it, and we, just speaking again for myself, I want to do whatever I can to help the craft school because it's a parking issue for them. We're hopeful that this language will be accepted and we'll be able to go forward. Is there anything else anyone wants to add anything?
I guess I just want to reiterate, at least at this time, I would say that the town and the state are working very cooperatively to try to find the language that will work. So, you know, again, the indication is that this, we will have something that the select board could approve, hopefully shortly.
So unless, if anyone else have anything they'd like to add on this? Anyone here? Anyone on the board? If not, what I would propose is hopefully we'll get an answer soon, and this can be revisited at the very next meeting, which is, I think, the 14th of March.
Yeah. So since it's a decision item, do you want to make a decision to table?
I would entertain a motion to table this and reschedule it for March 14th.
So moved. Second.
Okay, it was pretty close.
Deferred.
And who went first? Jerry or Colleen?
No, Colleen.
Yes. Colleen? It's okay. Okay. Moved by Colleen, seconded by Jerry. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? All right. Next item is item number 12. Consider accepting Harrington Village infrastructure. And hello, welcome again. And Joe, why don't I turn it over to you, and you can give us a quick summary of where we're at.
And I'll probably be quickly turning it over to Ann Janda, who knows the issue. I don't, besides, I think if there's a theme for tonight, we're trying to tie up some of the loose ends from the select board year. One was the tree management plan. We were trying to do the parking lot lease as well. The other one was Harrington Village. This has come before the board a few times. At the last meeting, at least what I gathered from the board was, yes, you in fact wanted to take over the infrastructure, so we reduced their letter of credit by 90%, and then the goal was before town meeting for the board to officially take it over. I don't think we have every T-crossed or I-dotted on the documents, but I believe that it's staff's position that the select board could take it over tonight contingent on finalizing the documents, and I better leave it there, and Ann knows this issue much better than I do.
Okay, Ann, and I don't see David Marshall. He's not here tonight, is he? But we have Kathy Beyer from Housing Vermont here. Hello. Ann Janda.
Right, so on December 13th, we got the message from the board that you were interested in taking over the infrastructure at Harrington Village, except for the sewer lines. And so you asked us to go back and take care of all of the details that need to be taken care of to see if we could do that. So since then, Kathy has redone the, she's created an amendment to the irrevocable offer of dedication, which takes out the sewer infrastructure as an offer. So that was a big piece. The other piece for us, for the town, was to make sure that we were comfortable with the stormwater infrastructure underneath Harrington Avenue, because taking over Harrington Avenue means taking over everything inside of it. And so we had our stormwater consultant, which is the South Burlington Public Works Department. They came out with their cameras, which are really very cool, by the way, and went underneath and looked at all the infrastructure. It all looks good. There's just one little piece that they felt that we should ask Housing Vermont or CHT to take care of. And Kathy has said that they've already started looking into that. And so that's one of the caveats. The other caveat is South Burlington is also very adept at putting together stormwater permit agreements. We've never done this before, but there is a stormwater permit for Harrington Village. And if we take over a certain percentage of the infrastructure, we become a co-permittee. So in order to make sure that if, you know, down the road, there's something that needs to be taken care of stormwater-wise, it's really clear to both parties, the town and Harrington Village, who's responsible for what. We've drafted an agreement. We're still looking at the agreement. It still needs to be executed and sorted out. So that's another caveat, is that we come to a mutual agreement on that. And the other piece is that the town attorney looked at all of the deeds and the amendment to the irrevocable offer of dedication. I think you'll see in your memo that he just wanted to make sure that you were all aware that you would become, the town would become, a co-permittee on the stormwater permit. The way I understand it, unless you have any other questions, I think it's important to understand that the agreement spells out that Harrington Village is responsible for renewing the permit, and that they're responsible for paying the fees as well, and that they would charge us for the percentage that we are co-permittee on. So that'd be like 16.5%. Yeah.
All right. Thanks. And Kathy, is this, please feel free to say whatever you want, but is this proposal something that you're supportive of?
Yes, we're all set.
That could make it real easy for I think it's something that many of us on the board, if not all of us, want to help, you know, and I'm very happy, Joe, that you made sure that this was timely taken care of pursuant to what the board's wishes were to get it done during this term. So thank you. Great work. And if that's good, if
I'd like to second that, and kudos to you, Anne, for the for your work here. What I'm going to raise this, as a question does not affect my complete whole support of this proposal, but and I well understand the throughput problems with the private pump station, but is there a suggestion here that sometime in the future the sewer infrastructure might be acceptable or accepted or looked at again, or are we, I'm not looking for a definite answer so much as, is it off the scope for a while?
Well, the staff has suggested that it be off the table.
Okay.
I think what has happened is we've learned from a past experience that having public infrastructure pass through private infrastructure and then back into public infrastructure just creates too many problems.
Yeah.
And then, you know, when we talked to Kathy about it, she agreed, so.
Yeah, that's changed the whole town's policy and practices in several areas.
So, you know, going forward, live and learn, you know, we'll do things differently when we're working with developers if we know they want us to take over the infrastructure.
Jerry, thanks for your nice comments about Anne's work. Well deserved. Josh, please.
Yeah, and I don't know who to direct this to, but I know, and it says here about the reduction of the line of credit is down to 10%, and I can't remember what the line of credit is for and when does that disappear? I mean, or what do we have any, is that part of the whole?
I think it'll disappear once the town takes over the infrastructure, right? And it's
actually, it was one detail I didn't discuss with Ann. Technically, you accept the infrastructure and then you would, in a separate vote, agree to release that last 10%. So we forgot to put that in front of you tonight. Okay. I guess we can come back and do that.
All right. Is there, are you comfortable with including that as a separate motion?
I would be, I don't see any reason why the board couldn't do that.
It would still
tonight,
be contingent upon
contingent
the
upon,
yeah. Yes.
You know, our acceptance of it.
So would somebody like to make a
really
motion? And I would just suggest if we make it that you add language that includes the reduction of the 10% down to zero. Contingent.
It's a long motion.
Yeah. It's a long motion.
It was written specifically.
If Sam Feinelberg was here, he would sing it.
So move to accept the Harrington Village Amendment to the 2013 Irrevocable Offer of Dedication with the revised associated warranty deeds, make Harrington Avenue and its associated stormwater infrastructure public, as long and a reduction of the 10%
bond requirement.
Line of credit.
Bond requirement to
bond
zero.
Bond requirement. As long as the town has an easement to the sewer infrastructure, an acceptable stormwater maintenance agreement is negotiated, one storm drain is repaired, and responsibility for any future sewer appurtenances?
Right.
Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. Due to road maintenance is solely Harrington Village's, and make the water infrastructure public as long as the town is given all necessary easements for access.
Great.
Thank you.
That was excellent.
Second.
Moved by Colleen, seconded by Jerry, and just as a point of clarification, the reduction would be from 10% to zero. Does everyone understand that?
Yes.
Right. Great. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you very much. We tried to get it done. I think we did. Thanks.
And you don't have to come back.
All right, next item is item number 13. Consider approving a grant application for the Better Roads Program. This could be a one-minute item, right, Joe?
Well, you know, Ann's here, and she knows this better than me, but, you know, again, all grant applications need to be approved by the Select Board per our charter, so here it is. Why don't you explain it real quick, Ann? It would be easier.
There's about 480 feet of storm drain on Juniper Ridge Road that is failing. It's a rusted pipe, and the concern is total failure. So we're applying for this grant in order to repair it as soon as possible. The fear, if it totally fails, is that the water that in a large storm event that would go into the Monroe Brook, if there's failure in this storm line, it would push a lot of pollution right into the Monroe Brook, which is already impaired.
Can we use the same grant last year to do Brook Lane, right? Or was that
well, we applied for Brook Lane to the same grant. We did not get it. We applied again for Brook Lane to the ecosystem restoration grant, and we got it.
And it's a $52,000 grant or so, and a $12,500 town match.
Yes.
Pretty good deal.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. All right, someone like to make a motion?
So moved.
Jerry moves to authorize the town of Shelburne submission of a fiscal year 2018 Vermont Better Roads grant application in the amount of $52,607, of which the town match will be $12,607 for the replacement and upsizing of 485 feet of failing culvert at Jupiter Ridge. Right.
Did you do it all in one time?
Yes. Moved by Jerry and seconded by Colleen.
No, John.
John. Okay, I mix you guys up all the time.
Sorry.
You look completely alike. All right, any discussion? Anyone here have anything they'd like to add? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right. Next item. Last item almost. discuss preparations for town meeting, and you threw this up because you want to know who's going to bring the cookies or what?
That's right. Well,
and we can just blame you.
Again, I guess I put in there jokingly. I mean, you can kind of leave it up to me to plan things on behalf of the select board, which maybe is the easiest thing, unless the select board as a whole has a direction that it wants to go for Monday night.
The only thing I just want to remind everybody, I mentioned in comments, is at the meeting we're going to be awarding the Colleen Hay Public Service Award. So. That's all I have. Anybody have anything else? Otherwise, it's a town meeting. It's the same as usual. Yep. All right. Someone like at 8:40,
hey,
8:39, to move to adjourn by Colleen. Seconded by Nora. No, sorry. Seconded by Josh. any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
We are adjourned. We are going to the Bearded Frog.
Congratulations. Thanks, guys.